let's start the show.
For Thursday, March 9th, 2017. Welcome to This Is Only a Test, the official podcast of tested.com.
Oh, whoa.
Right.
Look at that fucking squirrel on my bird feeder.
And then suddenly, the Enterprise D's bridge.
Oh, hey.
Oh, hey there. You know, that dubstep intro can only mean one thing, that we are getting a double weeks of Will Smith back on This Is Only a Test for the second part of our GDC discussion.
Hello.
The one and only Will Smith.
The one and only.
There is no other. Welcome, everyone, to this week's podcast. I can't believe it's just been a week. GDC feels like a year ago now. So much has happened. But I want to also welcome Kishore Hari, our co-host here. How are you doing, Kishore?
I'm doing okay.
Yeah, seems to be a lot going on in the world. There seem to be two big topics we're going to jump in this week. Last week, we recorded before Jeremy and I went back to GDC to do a bunch of game demos. We're going to talk about that. But who here saw Logan?
Oh, if we're going to talk about Logan, we got to just dive right into pop culture news.
Wow.
Jeremy left me the soundboard. I'm going to use it.
We're not messing around this week. That's right. Jeremy is out. He has jury duty, his civic duty to lay judgment on his peer.
If he was a real American, he would just not show up and like keep filing those notices saying, I can't come.
I don't live here anymore.
I have a podcast to do this week.
The secret is to move outside of San Francisco where they don't hit you for jury duty every 6 months.
Yeah, we have a lot of people, or just have a, like some of our state senators or politicians who just have addresses that they don't live at.
Ooh. Well, of course. Why wouldn't you? If you think you can get elected in a district, you just need a fake house.
Oh, yeah,
and then
exactly.
There you go.
Wow.
Logan, right?
Logan, the big pop culture thing of this week. You guys all did your homework. You guys all saw it, right?
I went and saw John Wick 2 instead, which was a fabulous film. Highly encourage people to watch it.
It's basically the same film.
The dog lives.
You know, that's the point. John Wick 2. John Wick is the Logan of the John Wick universe.
It's the inverse.
You know, John Wick 2 was not universally adored at Tested.
Well, anybody who doesn't like John Wick 2 is clearly a bad person.
Oh, okay. Let's get Mr. Savage on the phone.
Yeah.
I'm comfortable telling him that to his face.
On this week's Untitled, Will or Adam said he did not like John Wick 2 and because he thought that he wanted Keanu Reeves to be invincible. He was on the run for too much of the movie.
Well, he's really not going to like John Wick 3 then, I guess.
Yeah, where the whole movie he's on the run. I don't want to talk too much about John Wick 2. I loved it. Will, did you like it?
I thought it was really good.
Yeah.
I wish they explained too much.
They showed too much of the underworld. Morpheus was not needed. That whole subdivision of the underworld I thought was unnecessary.
I liked that they showed more factions, but I like the part with the women working on the old-fashioned typewriters and all that,
that
stuff.
That was fun.
It was unnecessary.
They had a lot of money spent, it felt like.
If you looked at that first movie, there was nothing in that first movie that was unnecessary. And there was a lot in this movie that was unnecessary.
Just enough. I mean, like it's a fun movie. The whole sommelier scene where he gets his weapons—that's completely unnecessary, but a fun scene.
That isn't unnecessary because that explains. That tells you how he gets weapons when he goes someplace that he has to go on an airplane. Like that is every bit as necessary as the scene with Uma Thurman in Kill Bill where she has the sword next to her seat on the airplane. Right? How do you get a sword, like a one of a kind killing weapon? Through airport security?
Well,
in that world, it just doesn't matter.
Maybe it's just part of your exoskeleton. That's how you get swords.
That's right, yeah. No walking through metal detectors in Logan, but it was, I enjoyed it.
Best Marvel movie ever? That's what you said last week.
I don't think so.
Spider-Man
I think people.
2?
No, X-Men 2 maybe.
X-Men 2 is really good, but if you watch that again, you will be disappointed in the modern.
I still think Avengers.
Avengers. Oh, no. Captain America.
Winter Soldier.
Winter Soldier, I think.
I might even go so far as to say Civil War.
No, a little too messy.
Yeah.
A little too much going on
there. There's too many characters introduced.
So, you could see me like reliving Civil War there. Be like, yeah.
I might say Iron Man 1 then. The first Iron Man set the tone for the whole thing. It's a multi-billion dollar empire.
And Logan may set the tone completely differently for the Fox faction of the Marvel, not cinematic, not the official Marvel Cinematic Universe. So I don't know how much we should talk about.
Well, I mean, it's Old Man Logan, which is I think everyone
knows.
It's
not Old Man Logan, though. It's just Old Logan.
What happens in Old Man Logan?
Does let's do this. So there was a comics book series called Old Man Logan, written by Mark Miller. And Mark Miller is a big, very prolific comics writer, did a bunch of stuff for DC'd and the Wildstorm imprint. And then he went into Marvel and wrote a bunch of the Marvel Ultimates universe. And then he did a bunch of Marvel like kind of Elseworlds stories, one of which was a miniseries called Old Man Logan, set in the far future where Logan, America is a wasteland. It's basically a road trip series where Logan, who is, he's old, but his regenerative factor, healing factor has gotten weaker. He's feeling the time has really hit him, but...
has he lost his memory again?
He hasn't lost his memory. He's married, has a family. It's basically John Wick, where... his family gets, like, he needs to go on the road to pay the local boss, like, the money, and he picks up Hawkeye, who's blind, and Hawkeye's, like, his road trip buddy, and then they travel across the U.S., going through different factions. So the supervillains all own different part of the U.S., like, Doom has a big middle America. I think Magneto has a big part of, or they're, like, all the big supervillains each own a different part of the United States.
So is this, like, is this post...
It's an alternate.
It's not a Days of Future Past spinoff or something like that.
It's just like this is a whole separate what if part of future.
It's Wolverine meets the road.
Exactly. It totally is Wolverine meets the road.
Okay.
The big character things in the Old Man Logan comic series is one, Logan refuses to release his claws. So the whole series is building up to the first time he unleashes the claws again. And then the two, the big twist, which. It's an old series. You're going to get spoiled. Don't worry about it. Is the reason he refuses, the reason he's retired and he's depressed, because he killed the X-Men.
Like all of them?
He killed all of them.
Wow.
Because he was brainwashed and he thought they were villains. And then he started going crazy. And then he was brutally killing them. And they refused to, they couldn't bear them to
they
stop
couldn't fight him,
because he was so powerful. But also, he was their friend. And they were trying to save him. And then he killed them all.
There's elements of that I think probably are in Logan.
So, yeah. So, I can spoil the Old Man Logan comic book series, because the movie Logan, while, yes, it is an older Hugh Jackman, an older Wolverine character, it's set in 2029, so set in like a future Bryan Singer X-Men universe, it's not the same.
The
it's
first
not...
Bryan Singer X-Men universe or the Days of Future Past X-Men
See, there are
Bryan
two
Singer universe?
I think it's the Days of Future Past one.
Okay.
I think it's after Days of Future Past where Logan, I think someone did the math, because there was X-Men Origins Wolverine, which showed his origin, which is based on the Origins comic book storyline. I actually followed it pretty closely with James Hallett being his real original name. Yeah. He was a meek child, and
Sabretooth
kind of his half-brother. Yeah.
And it's terrible.
Okay. And
it's bad for reasons not related to Wolverine, though.
Someone did the math where if you follow when he was born, James Hallett, he was born in like the early, like the 1800s.
Yeah, 1800s.
Yeah. He has in the Marvel, the X-Men cinematic universe, the Fox cinematic universe, he has lived 196 years up till 2029.
Mm-hmm.
But his brain is like 200 and...
Oh,
because
he did some of it twice.
Because he did it twice with Days of Future Past.
Oh.
So he lived multiple timelines.
Wow.
Didn't he get shot in the head with an adamantium bullet in one of those movies,
too? X-Men Origins Wolverine.
Yeah.
That was terrible. So, you know, the reason it was called X-Men Origins Wolverine was because they were going to do a spinoff with a bunch of X-Men Origins Magneto. X-Men Origins and
that and then that movie came out and people are like,
No, we don't want that. No, just give me more X-Men. That's why they
Origins,
X-Men First Class.
Origins is ruined as a word forever. You can't put that in a movie now even.
Yeah. I like Logan. I don't think
Best Picture material.
I don't think it's best picture. Best of the great performances. Hugh Jackman is amazing in it. Patrick Stewart's amazing in it. The girl, Daphne Keene, I want to say, she's amazing in it. But I don't think the script holds up to the very end. Plus, if you have played The Last of Us, And a lot of people have been making those comparisons. The Last of Us is a far superior story than Logan, which is different. I know you can't compare video games to movies.
We both have Ellen Page. They both have Hugh Jackman.
Yeah. One is a two-hour story you're trying to tell, and one is a story you maybe live with for 10 or 20 hours.
How did you feel about the Wolverine, the Japan one?
I didn't like it either. Same director, James Mangold.
It was okay.
Yeah. I thought it was a waste.
I wish Darren Aronofsky had ended up directing that. I feel like that would have been a real weird movie with him in charge.
I actually like the source comic for that a lot.
Yeah, the source comic's great. Like, the idea of Wolverine being, he's a samurai-type character. Mm-hmm. He's a Ronin-esque character. He has a code of honor. He travels the world. He fights swords with blades. He's a Western character set in Japan. That trope is very... there's lots to like about that, right?
It's very appealing. Bone claws. I like that you got to see the bone claws in a movie.
But then if that movie fell back to him fighting a giant robot, essentially.
Yeah, the ending leaves a lot to be desired.
All of these X-Men, the Wolverine-specific movies have had bad endings.
And a lot of it people blame on, well, because Fox, they don't have the rights to Spider-Man. They don't have the rights to Captain America. No. They have the rights to... Not the X-Men. They have the rights to Fantastic Four, but they have the rights to mutants.
Yeah.
And so it felt like in every movie that they had to just throw mutants in there. And the best thing I can say about what Deadpool and what Wolverine have brought to, and Logan have brought, is that they're not packed with mutants for the sake of being packed with mutants. Now, I don't think going forward, studios should say, oh, wow, Logan made $88 million in opening weekend. It's a rated R movie. Deadpool made 90-something million as a rated R movie. Rated R is the way to go. That's completely misunderstanding the fact that the reason the Logan is successful isn't because it was a gritty Wolverine movie. It's because it's a Wolverine. People have been waiting for this for a long time. They built up to it.
Those characters are R-rated characters.
That's the other thing, yeah.
And I think there's so many, like if we get a Silver Surfer R-rated movie, you'd be like, what the hell is this?
A Fantastic Four R-rated movie is not going to help anybody.
And Fantastic Four is... You have to look not just back at the source material, but what resonated with the fans. Like, people like Wolverine because, yeah, he's a badass. Because his weapons, he healed quickly, and you can show gore and him healing up. Fantastic Four, it's about adventuring. It's about a family adventure. Like, Fantastic Four is closer ties to... what's that space movie with the family that's lost in space? Yeah, than it does with...
Well, it's like Swiss Family Robinson, kind of.
Exactly. Yeah. Than it does with Spider-Man or the Avengers. Anyway, I still recommend it. Go watch Logan.
If you had to watch Logan or Lego Batman, which would you recommend?
That's a tough question. See, if you had said Logan or John Wick 2 again, yeah. I would say John Wick 2.
Yeah.
Wow.
Immediately. If Logan or Lego Batman...
Do you not like Lego Batman?
I love Lego Batman. Oh. I watched that with John Wick in the double feature. So in terms of those movies, I think I like
weird
John Wick
feature.
2, Lego Batman, Logan.
Okay.
This seems like an incredible March. Like, March is usually not a good month for movies, and there's been some real stars.
The same thing's happening with games, too. Like, it has been a bananas month for video games. That Horizon Zero Dawn is an incredible game.
I haven't played it, but I heard nothing but good things.
Yeah, Zelda, which we'll talk about it in length, I'm sure, in a little bit, is incredible. Neo, the kind of action combat game, I haven't played it. It's supposed to be really good. And then there's a Square RPG that's coming out, I think, next week that's also super duper good.
It's almost like the content creators knew we needed something to have distractions from in the real world.
Well, then I hope they have 4 years worth.
What else is going on in pop culture?
So speaking of other Marvel stories, cinematic stories, or maybe better told in long form, we have the first reviews for Iron Fist out today.
Broke your heart, didn't they?
What's Iron Fist?
Iron Fist is the last defender in the Netflix Marvel series. So he's the last character following Luke Cage. With Jessica Jones and Daredevil.
So they had a four character series? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the following the Iron Fist will be the Defenders, where they all come together.
It's the Avengers, but for the streets.
This is Hell's Kitchen?
Yeah.
It's all basically some parts of New York. Okay.
But more importantly, Iron Fist is one of Norm's favorite characters of all time.
Let me guess. Iron Fist's power is that he can punch things and his fist doesn't hurt.
That's basically close. It. Yeah, very yeah. close.
Very clear, very
so he's
close.
Basically a Luke Cage, but only the hand.
Yes, it's martial arts too.
Okay. This sounds like the least compelling of these four characters. Sorry, Norm.
Guess what the reviews say? This is the least compelling of the four series. They'd get trashed in reviews.
I'm so disappointed. I think it's like 33% Metacritic right now. It's a Netflix show. I mean, the story of Iron Fist is very much the story of like a Doctor Strange, right? It's mm-hmm. I think Doctor Strange combined with Iron Man.
So it's like Eastern mysticism combined with technology?
Combined, not technology, but billionaire.
Oh, okay.
Like a rich guy gets lost.
Is he a rich white guy?
Yeah, it's a rich white guy.
Of course.
So maybe Green Arrow. Green Arrow combined with Doctor Strange. He gets lost in the mountains, learns the martial arts and the magical arts.
Do they use the word spirit quest?
They basically goes on a spirit quest. He fights a dragon.
Hmm.
And then he defeats the dragon, earns the mantra of the Iron Fist.
I think
Fist.
That's probably a pretty big spoiler. Because I'm sure this is going to be like a flashback kind of thing.
That's my problem with the Marvel series, Netflix series. They all have the same formula where they throw you in. It's a great first two episodes. And then at the end of a cliffhanger at episode three, then they have three episodes of flashback. And this is how they get a 10-episode series.
Why? So they did two series of Daredevil, right?
Mm-hmm.
They did two series of Jessica Jones.
Not yet. Only one.
Oh, there's only one, but there's going to be another one, right?
Yep, presumably.
And then
Luke Cage
only gets one series?
No, all these shows.
All these are going to get two series before they make the Defenders?
We'll not before.
We'll see.
All of these, and that's a lot, right? Like, Netflix signed a big deal where, I don't think they estimated how successful these shows would be. Originally, when they signed the deal, it was like Daredevil's going to get one season. All these characters are going to get like one season, miniseries to shine, and it'll culminate in this big TV event.
Yeah.
And now it's every one of these characters are becoming their own multi-season shows. Spinoffs are happening where the Punisher is going to get his own show spun off of season two of Daredevil. Defenders is its own miniseries. And it's at some point, like, how do you logistically get all these actors together and get all these scripts to be good?
I mean, this is the same problem that they have with the films now, but on a TV scale.
Yeah.
I think everybody was surprised at the reaction to Daredevil. Like, I was surprised at the reaction to Daredevil. It was something kind of new. It was really, really violent. It was really shot in an interesting way, and people really went bonkers for it. And then Jessica Jones came out, it was even better. And I don't think anybody expected that.
And if you think about just how much sheer amount of content they're making, if they're doing, and I don't expect them to do, they're not doing five seasons of a show every year. It's not going to be Luke Cage and Daredevil and Jessica Jones and Punisher and Iron Fist and Defenders out every year. They're going to stagger this stuff out.
Like two
right?
a year is pretty much what they
two of these, right. But like if you're paying $15 a month for Netflix and you're getting like the Marvel TV cinematic universe, that's worth that $15 alone. But now you're also getting House of Cards and Stranger Things and all these random
a
movies.
A bunch of kids' shows.
And kids' shows and stand-up shows. Like, that is an unbelievable investment they've put into their content, original content.
I was just reflecting on it. Like, Netflix is still $10, right?
I think it's 15.
No, I think it's 10.
It's only 10?
Yeah, it's only 10. I was just
thinking it went up from 9 to 10.
It's now on an equivalent level as HBO, which is 15.
It's like, more. It's more content than HBO.
I get
it's
HBO
more
content, for 10 with Comcast, I think.
But the idea of which do you like better, HBO or Netflix? Because HBO puts out some of the best shows on television, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think Netflix is rapidly approaching that, and it's not like the sheer size of the library is awesome for us because we have kids, and so we, you know, I use it more than HBO in that regard, but.
But
the
HBO,
volume of stuff they produce is incredible. Though,
it is
right? compared to HBO. They
but
produce
HBO
a lot
is,
more.
Is short. It's consistency. HBO has a better batting average.
Yeah.
I feel like, and still gets House of Cards, Veep, or not House of Cards. I'm sorry, Veep, John Oliver, and Game of Thrones, and Silicon Valley. All of those like are enough to sustain my $15 a month. Plus, they can do things like The Night of.
Well, and the if you like documentaries, HBO does a really good job of curating mm-hmm. documentaries.
Yeah, so it's going to be tough for a service like CBS All Access to get people to pay however much they want to pay just for access to Big Bang Theory and maybe one new show, Star Trek
Survivor.
Discovery.
Oh, wait, I got to jump in with one tangent. I saw somebody recut a Big Bang Theory episode with Ricky Gervais as the only laugh track, and it was brilliant. Show notes.
And all these streaming services, but Star Trek Discovery is the CBS All Access flagship show. And we finally have some casting news for the captain of the show. I thought they cast the lead already.
I thought that was supposed to be... I thought the show was supposed to be out now.
It was supposed to be out now.
It was supposed to be out months ago, and it's been delayed multiple times.
So that means it sucked and they just keep reshooting it?
No, they don't have a... I don't think they... They stopped production or they slowed down production because... what's his name? Brian
Fuller left.
Brian Fuller, the showrunner, left the show. So I bet they had to restructure some of the production. And it only turns out they just cast the co-star for this, one of the leads, Jason Isaacs, as the captain.
Who's Jason Isaacs?
Jason Isaacs played the villain in The Patriot. He's also Lucius Malfoy's father.
And Draco Malfoy.
Yes.
No.
He was Lucius Malfoy. Yeah, Draco Malfoy's father. He's a stern British man.
Does he have the white hair? I mean, that would be like a giant, super straight white wig.
I don't think he has the white hair.
I don't know about this. This is like the same thing as like when you see Sean Bean in a heroic role as opposed to a villainous role. How do you feel about that?
The secret of Star Trek captain casting is that you never feel good about it at the moment, but it's usually the right person, except when it's the guy from Quantum Leap.
That was more of a... Actually, I thought Scott Bakula was not the worst thing in that show.
In fairness, I watched one episode of that, and when they got to the decontamination gel, I was like, okay, I know what this is. I'm good.
I thought the woman from Walking Dead was going to be the captain.
And I think she's not the captain, but she's the lead. I think the show's going to be about her, but the captain will not be the lead, which is an interesting take. I mean, all the Star Trek shows, the recent ones, have been ensemble pieces.
Yeah.
No one in DS9 was the main character.
The main character shifted around. Like, each season was about a different person's arc, kind of, right?
And when you're doing 26 episodes a season, you had to give everyone some type of story. I didn't really watch Enterprise, but I don't know if that was... Was that the Archer's show? No, right. Yeah.
I like Archer.
No, I'm just saying no.
No.
Archer's
no,
pretty
no,
good.
No. Okay.
He's a spy, but he's kind of a jerk, and then he's not really a spy. Great. He loves Gator.
I do like the idea of a Archer Star Trek crossover.
That would be amazing.
Who would the mom be? Like the voice of the computer?
No.
Yes, come on. She would just nag the shit out of everyone.
She'd be the Beta Z counselor. Maybe she's just the captain's mom.
Okay, I think we got to go to tech. Oh.
Hey, Norm, I have a Logan question.
Yep.
Is this the end of Hugh Jackman as Wolverine?
He said he was going to retire after this film. Okay. He was happy with how it ended. Same with Patrick Stewart. Is retiring from Professor X after this film.
It seems right.
They're
both kind of old.
Yeah.
They've been doing it for like 20 years. Yeah.
It was 97. It was 2000 when X-Men 1 came out.
Almost 20 years.
I saw that the week I moved to San Francisco, actually, at the Metreon. Which was new and shiny then.
We've grown up with those characters. All right, technology news. Well, the one big piece of technology, we're not going to get to what we've been testing, save us for what we've been testing, is Nintendo Switch. Nintendo Switch is out. Oh, nice. Mm. Nice. Can I record that? I want that.
Jeremy has the audio of it somewhere.
Yeah. Will, you have a Nintendo Switch?
I have a Nintendo Switch.
I have one in my hands right now.
I was real up and down on that pre-order until the Breath of the Wild reviews started coming out. And then I was like, okay, I'm probably going to get this.
I think there was a message.
No, I had a pre-order.
But you're going to cancel.
But I was going to cancel.
But you could have sold it. They're sold out everywhere.
I mean, that's fine. But I'll say I'm going to sell it and then put it in the back of my car and it'll pull out in 3 months.
Wow. Kishore, you shared a picture when the Breath of the Wild reviews came out. It was 10 out of 10, 10 out of 10, 10 out of 10. And you said you might have to eat some crow this week.
I might. We're gonna see. But also, so, there's an undercurrent too.
Yes.
So let's
talk about the hardware first, right? None of us had gotten early access to a Switch, so we got this basically release day. It works as advertised. So you had a Wii U, Will?
Yeah.
The screen size of the Switch and the Wii U are the same size, 6.2 inches. But yeah. to me, the Switch feels like a bigger screen, smaller device.
There's less bezel for sure. It's a little bit. I actually like the way the Wii U kind of fits, holds.
It's contoured on yeah, the grips.
It's a little bit. It's a you know. There's a little bit less finger action on holding it. But it's this is this.
But
is
the
a,
Wii U's heavier though. You don't mind.
Kind of doesn't matter because okay. it has like knurled grips on the sides. Mm-hmm. Not knurled, but it has big chunky grips that you can grab onto and like. Like it's comfortable in my hands, my kid can hold it, it's all good. I feel it's a little scary having a four-year-old holding this thing because it's a lot less fragile. Like
and a lot less ergonomic.
Yeah.
So the actual device, which the big difference is that there is no set-top console split off from the screen, it is all one thing.
It's what people thought the Wii U was.
It is essentially, right, when lay people came over and picked up the Wii U screen, they thought that it was all running, but it was all streaming. It was all being encoded and sent over 720p to that screen. Here it's all being rendered locally, and it essentially is a tablet.
I don't even think it's 720p on the Wii U. I think it's lower than 720p. Yeah, it's somewhere between 480 and 720.
Mm-hmm. Well, here is it's an ARM-based tablet. Mm-hmm. It runs on the NVIDIA the Tegra X1, which has been in devices like the Google Pixel C tablet. It's been in the NVIDIA Shield TV device. So it's been around. It's an old chip, it's a newer version of an old chip.
Is it in the current Shield tablet, or is that one newer?
The current Shield TV, I believe, has the Tegra X1.
Okay.
So my skepticism with the Switch was that were we basically going to get games that look like mobile games mm-hmm. on this? And so, especially when they announced that Breath of the Wild would come out on Wii U simultaneously as the Switch, like, was Breath of the Wild going to look like just like a game you could play on your iPad or a game you could play on your Shield? And to some extent, yeah, it's not. It's like Xbox 360 graphics.
I mean, that's essentially what the Wii was a little bit like an underpowered Xbox 360. It's a rough analogy.
And that's I think that's but that's fine. And it's a tablet, it's a touchscreen. It's a nice capacitive touchscreen. It's a little thicker than a tablet. It's small. The battery's in there.
It's got active cooling though, which is unusual for a tablet.
Yeah, so it's a little thicker than your iPad would be, but there is a exhaust on the top. You can actually see the copper cooling, mm-hmm. The heat pipe in there. It has cartridges, and it does as advertised. Plays those games.
Does it get hot even with the active cooling?
So when it's in the dock, it gets warm. Like the fan cranks up sometimes when you're playing games. I left it in my bag in my laptop sleeve, and it got turned on accidentally and got hot as shit in there with the fan going full speed and everything. But it cooled down in like 2 minutes and didn't seem to be any permanent damage.
Yeah. So the big the innovation, if you call it that, is that the controllers are wireless or locked in.
Well, I think they're still wireless even when they're locked in.
Are you sure about that?
I think that they charge, but I don't think that there's a data connection because I had read reports of people saying they had connectivity problems while it was actually in the
I don't think that's the case because you can turn on airplane mode, which turns off Bluetooth.
Oh, really?
And then you can still play the game when it's plugged in, but not when it's attached.
It doesn't look like there's any kind of physical connection though, Norm. I don't see how it would connect.
I mean, it has to charge somehow.
Well, I mean, it can charge on the metal. Because there's two pieces of metal on the edges here. I don't know. I'm interested. I didn't read any of the teardowns of this yet, so it looked like a nightmare to tear down. Saying it's just a tablet is a little bit weird.
I'm saying the form factor.
Yeah, but they did things like there's ported speakers on the bottom of the front, right? So the sound is actually good. You don't have to use headphones with it, like I tend to do with my tablet if I'm playing games on the airplane. I mean, obviously, if I'm playing games on the airplane, but if I'm laying in bed playing games on the iPad, I usually want to put headphones
and
on.
And it sounds decent.
Yeah, it sounds okay. Mm-hmm.
So
it gets plenty loud enough.
There absolutely is a connection because I have an airplane mode, and if you take the Joy-Con out, it says attach the Joy-Con controllers to the console. The Joy-Con cannot be used wirelessly when airplane mode is enabled.
Oh, okay. Good to know. We talked about that on Giant Bomb yesterday, and they weren't sure. So
yeah, the Joy-Cons work ergonomically. It is a less ergonomic Wii U tablet.
There's, as with many handheld devices, you find the way that you want to hold it. I know you were a big proponent of like the pinky grip for a long time
for phones. Yeah.
I find that I kind of tuck this into the palm of my hand and let my middle finger float the back of it, basically.
Yeah, if you're, I think if you're used to holding and gripping Contour controllers, actual, and they do sell like a Pro controller, just gripping with the bottom, the curved part of the Switch, the Joy-Cons, pressed into the cup of your hand, but trying to hit those two shoulder buttons, that's where it gets awkward for me.
I see. I don't have a problem. The thing, so I haven't noticed that. I have had, it's not as comfortable as, like I said, the Wii U or something like that. And you still have to put your hands in that not entirely healthy, not neutral position where your wrists are bent up a little bit and all that stuff. The thing that I love is that I can take the Joy-Cons off, put the straps on, and just hold them independent when I'm playing on the TV.
You can literally...
And I can just play... It's like having one of those split keyboards that you put on either side of your chair.
You could play just like leaning back, just like...
Well, you can get in the most... You can get in the perfect neutral wrist position.
They're not too really dainty.
You can play it lying down,
holding them like that.
No, they're fine. You get used to it really quickly. Mm-hmm. It's I mean, here, you can try. The thing that bums me out is that there's, because the Joy-Cons each serve as a standalone kind of
controller,
one P stick plus four button plus two shoulder buttons controller.
Yeah.
There's no good D-pad on this thing. So if you want to play games that need a D-pad, which are a little bit limited in 2017, you need to get the Pro controller.
Right. It only has a thumbstick.
Mm-hmm.
And then there are a separate accessory. So in the box, you actually get a lot of stuff. There's the fact that you get two actual separate controllers for multiplayer in one package, like there's no console that sells that today.
They haven't done that since the NES, I don't think. Maybe the SNES, you got two.
Yeah, the SNES, you got two. But they're basically two Wii, original Wii controllers.
Well, with a D-pad, with an analog stick instead of the D-pad.
Right, and with no nunchuck.
It's with more buttons.
Exactly. But like, the functionality of it being a motion controller that you can aim or you can use as a horizontal controller. But you get two of those, and then you also get a dock, which you get one power cable. So it's USB-C power and for video, and that gets plugged into the dock or for charging on the bottom. And then you also get these like, weird adapters that you plug in the top of the Joy-Cons to make the shoulder buttons more prominent.
They're called Joy-Con straps.
Right.
Is the name.
But you can't charge with those.
You can't charge with these on. There's also the thing that makes the two Joy-Cons into a relatively traditional gamepad.
Yeah, and I thought actually it was comfortable. I like playing with that.
It's not bad. Yeah.
It's merely a bracket with lights that tells you... that they're connected in the same controller.
It makes it easy to hold.
You don't feel like people are going to lose the little straps?
Almost certainly.
Yeah.
They're $6.
Oh, those, okay.
Yeah.
That's not bad.
I thought you needed to buy those, so I bought an extra set. So if anybody needs extra Joy-Con straps, I'm going to send them back to Amazon tomorrow.
And they have the shoulder buttons.
They have the shoulder buttons.
Right, to make those easier to use.
They make it a little bit easier to hold on to. The Joy-Cons and the tablet all have accelerometers and gyroscopes.
What do you feel about the haptics?
I haven't actually played anything that uses the haptics because I don't have 1-2 Switch. So the thing about the using the Joy-Cons as two-player controllers is okay if you're just kind of playing the kind of games that you might play with a bunch of people around a TV. But if I wanted to play something that I wanted to be competitive at, they're probably not a great solution for that.
Yeah.
Like I wouldn't play Samurai Gun for Blood in that kind of
situation. Or whenever, you know, Super Smash Bros. Comes out for this, you're going to want the Pro controller.
You're probably going to go get it some sort of weird gamepad adapter because Super Smash Bros. People are a little bit crazy.
They're Bluetooth, but can you use a third-party Bluetooth controller with this?
There's no way to pair a Bluetooth device with it. I can't even pair Bluetooth headphones with it.
You cannot pair Bluetooth headphones. It's only audio jack, 3.5mm jack.
It's the opposite of your iPhone 7 problem.
Wow. Yeah. That's bizarre. I mean, it's even though form factor wise, it is essentially a tablet running a tablet piece of hardware. There is no tablet functionality. You can't pair Bluetooth headphones. There are no apps. It's just games from the eStore.
Yeah.
A limited web browser to sign into internet in hotels, but you can't browse. You can't watch stream YouTube.
I think Nintendo had problems with YouTube being the vector that they're. Platform was rooted in the past, and maybe they're a little skittish about it this time.
Oh.
You think it's just walled garden for now, and they're going to open it up later?
I mean, it's never going to get open. Mm-hmm. It's never going to be an app store.
You want, like, is this device, like, okay, there are a couple different markets for Switch, right? There's you and me, which we have devices. We have laptops. We have phones.
Okay. Yeah.
We're okay. But also, the Switch is for a family who's buying this for their kid. Like, it could be their iPad replacement. And would you want them to have a streaming service thing like Disney XD on this? Like, and be able to watch video?
Look, if I could go back in time to a time when Disney XD was not on my Apple TV and we did not know as a family that it existed, I would happily do that.
So you think keep Nintendo smart to keep it a game focused device?
I don't long term, probably no. I feel like this was a really, really fast launch. If like you think about when we first started hearing about this about a year and a half ago.
But there's a difference between fast launch when and definitely from announcement to release, short as hell. Okay. But for product development, how long has it actually been with the patent leaks and the
speculation look,
that the NX name has been around for so long.
Hardware they've been working on, like the hardware development cycle is 5 to 10 years, and we only hear about the last 2 years of it usually. The thing I'm talking about is getting it in hands of third-party developers so they can build apps, or even internal developers so they can build apps for it, if they even want those kinds of apps on it, it's a time-consuming process and it takes a while. And when they mess it up, then the consequences are really bad. Yeah. If you look at what this thing launched with, if you look at what they sent to reviewers, and then you look at the day one patch, like basically it has a friends list and some parental controls, and that's pretty much it, right? There's nothing really you can do with the friends list. You can create an edit of me, and that's really all that there is there.
And
you can't even take save games off of it, which if right. you want to talk about things that are problematic.
Especially if people are possibly in launch window returning their Switches or if they have any problems, your save games are locked onto the system.
Well, or if you can't copy them to the SD card. You can plug it. So storage for the device is 32 gigs built in, which is paltry. But you can get, I think I bought a 128 gig card for like $25 or
you
something,
$30. You don't need a
High speed. I bought a fast one. I don't know if it makes any difference at all.
There's like very little difference in price these days between them.
Yeah. Like download speeds were fast on the game. So I've only bought Breath of the Wind Wild now. But I was pleasantly surprised by that because Nintendo has not been great at download speeds in the past. Mm.
How big did that game take up? How much space?
Like 12 gigs, 13 gigs installed. I think it was a 6 gig download.
Oh, that's not bad.
So like
it's full price with the smart thing. I mean, I bought via Amazon because Prime users get $10 off.
Yeah.
So
20%.
20% off. So
yeah, 20% off.
I like getting. I mean, and having the cartridge. It's nice. It tastes bitter.
You have the cartridge.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're gonna talk about that.
I tasted it. It tastes awful.
Yeah. Oh, we gotta. Do you have a cartridge? I haven't licked a cartridge yet.
Would you like to lick my Zelda cartridge?
Yeah, I will. I'll do it.
If you
have, I'll do
saved,
it in the science
don't,
minute.
Don't eject okay. it yet. I'm really impressed with the hardware. I feel like it's not as sturdy as Nintendo handheld stuff usually is, but it kind of splits the difference pretty well for an adult console and a kid console. If you have a kid that has like a 2DS because you were afraid they were going to break a 3DS, this is not the console for them. Like my daughter ham-fisted around and I'm constantly afraid she's going to drop it because I think if you drop on the Joy-Cons, they're just going to explode off basically.
I think that
because of the plastic to metal, basically.
Yeah, there's this weird balance. I don't know the expectation when people buy game consoles, like portable game consoles. PSP felt like a nice piece of electronics. Like it was shiny.
Yeah.
But most Nintendo consoles or handheld consoles, from the Game Boy to even the DS, the original DS, mm-hmm. even the DS Lite. Feel like plasticky toys.
They felt like old iPods, like the white plastic iPods, kind of. But
even less polished than that. I think if you look at other consumer electronics in the phone space, in the high end smartphone space, in the $300 like Android phone or even iPhone space or even iPad, there's a nice balance here. I think between a thing that feels like a toy, but feels much better than like the original DS.
So, original DS is a low point for Nintendo industrial design. I think the DS Lite is probably pretty good. The 3DS XL and new 3DS XL. Mm-hmm. Actually, the 3DS in general was pretty good. I don't know. It's gonna be really interesting to see how this thing evolves, right? Like if you look at it, there's some weird choices made. So they did all this work on parental control. So you set up an app on your phone, you connect your Switch to the app, and then you can say, okay, I want to only let my kid play 45 minutes of games each on weekdays, and they can play 2 hours on weekends, and they have to go to bed by 8 o'clock. And if they go past the time limits, I want you to just turn the machine off, right? Or send me a notification.
Which is consistent with what like Amazon's done with the Fire.
Right. And just to be clear, Amazon, does the best parental controls I've ever seen. Compared to that, Apple, Samsung, everybody else, Android in general is kind of hot garbage. But they made this machine specific. So it's not tied to an account on the machine that you can like type a PIN code or something to switch from your account to their account. It's as if Nintendo didn't think that a parent and a child would maybe share the same $300 console when it came out. And so like every time I want to play a game with blood, Zelda, I have to put my PIN code in, which
and,
just sucks. It's
and
just
this
lame.
Is also a device meant to be shared. You create multiple accounts. Yeah. As part of the normal setup process, the fact that it's two of these controllers, it is a buy one for the household, not buy one for each kid.
I mean, eventually it's going to be a buy one for each kid because we know what happens to prices on tablet hardware, right? This machine will not cost $300 in 2 years.
Sure. It's also already a year and a half old hardware.
Yeah.
There's nothing stopping Nintendo from doing a fancier version later.
And for right. the pure multiplayer experience in a house with multiple
You mean the
kids.
Couch multiplayer?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's great. It's unfortunate they kind of launched without one of those games. I mean, 1-2 Switch could have been that. Like, it seems like, I haven't played it, but from what everybody I've talked to, it sounds
should
like.
Should have been a pack-in.
Or $10 or $20. Like, I would have paid $20
yeah,
for it.
Not $40.
Wait, so what is like,
it's 50
let,
bucks.
Let's talk about the
is
games
50 bucks?
Part.
Yeah. 40 off on Amazon.
Yeah.
We should talk about the games. Are you disappointed with the launch? Because
well,
which is pretty much Zelda and 1-2 Switch.
We're less than
right?
1 week. To be clear, we are fewer
Four,
than
5 days.
A week from 7 days into launch. The games that it did come out with, Zelda, 1-2 Switch, Bomberman, and some of the stuff you can download, no one has exhausted that yet.
Yeah, Zelda's a 30 or 40 hour if you bust ass through it.
But it's
like.
Also fair to say that at launch right now, it is a Zelda playing device. You're buying a $360 plus tax Zelda playing machine where if you had the Wii U, you could have the same experience by just buying Zelda.
I would say that Shovel Knight is probably a pretty exceptional game that's been released on every platform known to man and it really benefits from a D-pad.
Okay.
So it like that's maybe not a great
and that's
example.
A side scroller.
Yeah, it's an NES. It's literally made with the limitations of the NES platform in mind. So like it uses the same kind of color palette restrictions and stuff like that, and it's very reminiscent of Zelda to the Adventure of Link. In a positive way. There's a couple of other interesting things like Snipper Clips is a neat kind of puzzle game. It's not suitable for kids. Like I would have loved to see Towerfall or Samurai Gun or Nidhog or any of those.
Nidhog with the Joy-Cons
like,
would be
yeah.
awesome.
Nidhog with the Joy-Cons would totally work.
Yeah, especially since once you switch, low latency is one of the selling points of this. A lot of the 1-2 Switch games require really, really fast response times. So, someone out there make Nidhog or an equivalent game for Switch. I mean,
damn.
It's so early to say whether this would be worth it, but if it ended up being a $300 console and maybe cheaper in a year or two, that you play just the first party titles, and who knows how good the new Mario game is going to be, but Mario Kart and the things you know they're going to get out on their flagship console,
yeah,
I'd be okay with that.
I mean, look, that's I buy every Nintendo platform with the exception that it's basically a first party game. Plus some weird shit. I would have loved to see some Professor Layton or Phoenix Wright or Etrian Odyssey or some of the kind of classic handheld games that you don't get to play on a TV usually. Monster Hunter is another like that. We'll see a Monster Hunter for this at some point. That'll be interesting.
The best thing is, and one of the reasons I think that this is now the best selling in console. Initial launch window console of all time for Nintendo. I think they said outsold the Wii.
That was there were some real like Reggie said in a New York Times article that it was the fastest 3 days that they've ever had or something like that. And if you think about how supply constrained the Wii was when they launched that,
so and it's still supply constrained for the Switch.
Not the same way.
You can't go out and buy one.
No, the Wii was gnarly.
You could go to the store on Friday morning and buy a Switch, and you could not get a Wii if you didn't pre-order.
Yeah, there are
for
fights
months.
Over the Wii.
Right. Like,
the Wii was out of stock until the next August or something.
Granted, this is not a culture as much as an immediate cultural phenomenon as the Wii. It's not as novel. But the thing that makes the Switch novel is so much of an immediate benefit and practical benefit than the things that made the 3DS novel, the thing that made the Wii U novel, or and maybe the Wii it wasn't a practical benefit, but it was a novel benefit that ended up being useful. But the Switch, it being the one console you're going to buy for your set top and mobile and also multiplayer in one box, that's a great value proposition.
I mean, if you're looking at that versus a PS4 Pro or even a PS4 Slim, then yeah. I mean, I think, look, part of the reason the Wii was out of stock for so long was it was one of the first things that used accelerometers, right? Like silicon accelerometers. And those were hard to come by in 2007 when the Wii came out, I guess. It's like this is the thing that they did that's smart here is that everything that's in this, with the exception of like the mechanical interface design of the Joy-Cons and stuff like that, is relatively easy to produce. So they shouldn't have, like, we shouldn't be sitting here in November talking about how hard it is to find a Switch for Christmas.
Well, yeah, they launched it in March, too. Right.
They will have missed a huge opportunity because we're right in the lull between the other systems.
Well, we're not really, though, because Scorpio is coming out this year and PS4 Pro just came out.
But those
out,
are high-end.
So. Well, but PS4 Pro is not the same as, like, a new system. That's just a 0.5.
I mean...
It's okay. It's really on Microsoft to screw up the Scorpio.
I think the fundamental thing that's changing with consoles is that the console business is changing to the point that we're not going to have. I don't think we're going to see jumps that break compatibility with old games anymore. I think we'll see games that maybe don't support really old hardware in the future. You know, original Xbox One, original. First release Xbox One pre-Scorpio in 5 years we won't see, but I think you'll be able to take your copy of Halo 5 and play it on an Xbox One forever and ever, amen. And right. I think that this is a representative of that as well. I think that this is Nintendo's bet on that as well, because look, NVIDIA is going to keep making new Tegra chips, and it should be relatively straightforward to port that stuff forward and make the resolutions better, make the screen better, make the industrial design on the interface between the hardware and the controllers and the tablet better.
Some pain points for early adopters. One, some people are getting dead pixels on their LCDs. Nintendo has come out and said that, sorry, some of this is normal. And if anyone has bought a big high-resolution monitor knows, it's unfortunate, but you can only get... You can only have the manufacturer be at fault if it's a certain percentage of dead pixels. So if you have like one dead pixel on your Switch, you might be stuck with it. And it might be a stuck pixel, but I don't know if there's anything you can currently run on the Switch to see if you can cycle out and unstick that pixel.
You need a web browser. Yeah. I mean, people have gotten into the web browser by kind of gaming the Wi-Fi connection stuff, and that there are web tools that will let you do that.
Two, the kickstand sucks.
Yeah.
It is a terrible angle, and if you have a 3D printer, you can go to Thingiverse right now and 3D print a better stand for it at three different angles, I believe. We have a video going out later today of all things, if everything works properly. We made our kickstands with a laser cut design, and we'll be releasing those files as well for a much more comfortable 45-degree angle.
It's like they never used the first Surface.
And also, hello, the charging port. So USB-C, great, because it's reversible, but one of the issues that because it's reversible is that the dock, but you know which direction to put it in. You want to put it in with the screen facing out. The screen is plastic, so maybe get a screen protector. I really hate screen protectors. I'm conflicted here.
I like that they did a plastic screen because it means that when my four-year-old drops it, it's less likely to... The expensive part of it is less likely to explode.
It would scuff, not crack.
Yeah, I mean, look, if I have to choose between cracks and scratches, I'll take scratches because... And there are a lot of third-party glass screen protectors out there now. People are complaining about scratches on the front of the device. It seems like there's conflicting reports about that stuff, you know... I did watch my daughter jam mine in backwards and was like, oh God, this is how it gets scratches. And
did you get a screen protector?
I did not get a screen protector. I think I might get one of those glass ones though, because you can get a piece of glass that you basically stick on the front, and that seems like it would be the best of both worlds.
I'm gonna research and see what the best option is and get one attached. Also, when you use the kickstand, you can't charge it because it blocks the USB charging port. So elevate it.
In Japan, they sell an accessory that's like a little stand. It's like it holds it up a couple inches, so you can put it on that while
you're... Like an official accessory?
Accessory.
Wow. That's bad design.
They also have the equivalent of a smart cover so that it hooks on the top somewhere and then kind of flips over to cover the glass when you put it in your bag, which I would love to have. Like that.
Yeah, like that'd be like a kid's cover, basically. Yeah.
Or for me to chuck it in my bag.
Hmm. All right.
Can we talk about the Japanese store real quick?
Sure.
It's cool and people don't know about it.
Yeah.
It's super, super easy to set up a Japanese account on your Switch. You basically go to Nintendo, create a new Nintendo account with, you can use your same email address. If it's Gmail, you can put a dot in there or whatever, and it'll, you know, it'll show up to Nintendo as a separate email address.
Wait, this is on the website, or?
So first you go to their website.
Nintendo's Japanese website.
No, you can go to the U.S. website.
Oh.
When you create the account, it says what region do you live in? It usually defaults to America because that's where your IP address says. You just change it to Japan. Mm-hmm. Then create a new account on the Switch after you've confirmed that account, and log into that Nintendo account, and you'll have access to the Japanese store where you can download Japanese demos.
But can you play it then? You can only play with that account?
So you once it's on the machine, you can play with whichever account you want.
Fantastic. I'll have Japanese Norm download the new games.
I have Japan Will downloading games. You can't use, before you put your credit card in America, make sure you don't have international transaction fees. Because a lot of U.S. credit cards will charge you extra on top of the conversion fee, like $20. So don't do that. I have been told by video game experts at GiantBomb.com that there are sites that you can go to that they will scratch off the Japanese points cards and you can give them American cash money for that, that won't invoke American transaction fee or international transaction fees. But there are also several demos. Like, you can download a demo for Puyo Puyo Tetris. There are guides online that tell you how to, you know, which buttons to press to get to the game mode that you want. And if it's a game like, I think Blaster Master had an English translation already built in, it detects that your console is an English console and will play the English version if there is an English version when you buy from the Japanese store. So it's super easy to import Japanese games.
Are the demos time-based? Are they just level-based, feature-limited?
It's really hard to say because I don't really speak or read Japanese at all. And both of the games that have demos right now, Dragon Heroes and Puyo Puyo Tetris, are full kanji.
Will, you want in on this Nintendo Switch tempered glass screen protector?
Yeah, what was
2-pack? Yeah, $11.
I'll give you $5.50 for it.
All right.
Are you guys both happy with your choice of design? You didn't want the colored one?
I would have gotten the colored one.
Seeing the photos, and I like the and after using the gray one, I wish I got the red and blue.
Brad told me that, so when you buy the handheld, the standalone controllers, they're reversed. So when you order it, you get red on one side and blue on the other. It's always the same. When you buy the standalone controllers, if we want to talk about what the big knock against this thing is, the accessories are crazy expensive.
Yeah, $70 for two extra Joy-Cons.
Yeah. Oof. The charging dock is like $40. The Pro Controller was $60 or $70. But Pro Controller is really good. It has an NFC dongle. It has all the accelerometers and gyroscopes and stuff in it. And it feels really comfortable. It's nice to use. But damn, that is an expensive gamepad.
Hopefully it'll come down in price console will.
Nintendo shit never comes down in price.
Well, the console will. I mean, device will.
Yeah.
But I don't...
Yeah. The Joy-Cons, I was shocked at how expensive they are for kind of what you... Like, if you have three kids, it would make sense to buy a second set of Joy-Cons. But otherwise, maybe skip that.
All right.
And there's no real way to charge them either without buying the charging Joy-Con pad. I think
that is it for our Nintendo Switch.
Yeah,
coverage.
All right, so we'll continue on with GDC coverage last week. Will, did you get to go to the second half of GDC? Did you get to walk around the floor, see any demos, play anything? What were things that stuck out for you?
One of my favorite parts of GDC. There's now like four or five kind of indie game sections. There's Mild Rumpus, which is, I don't know who does that, but it's, I think it might be Brandon Boyer. It's like they had a different crop of indie games there every day. I think my favorite that I played there was Tumbleseed, which is from some of the folks that made Threes. And it's a kind of roguelike platformer thing where you have a bar that goes across the screen. The left stick controls how high the right side of the bar, how fast the right side of the bar goes. The left stick controls how fast the left side of the thing on. Basically, there's two points, and pushing the left stick makes the point on the right go up. Pushing the left stick makes the point on the left go up. Pushing the right stick makes the point on the right go up. And there's a bar rested between them, and you have to roll this seed across essentially a maze while it's on this bar. And it's roguelike, so the game is different every time. It's really, really, I'm doing a terrible job explaining it. It's a lovely game and everybody should play it when it's out.
I'll put a link to the preview in the show notes.
Yeah. If you watch a video for like 3 seconds, you'll understand exactly how the game works. And I expect to spend a lot of time when it's out. I also, went to the Alt-Control GDC, which is where all the people that hack hardware into games play stuff. I played this game called, I got to look at the name. Something Brian. Super Brian. It's a ball tracking, like ski ball type game. So you have two little balls. You throw them down a track, and when the balls go into the machine, there's cameras that detect their velocity and direction, and then the physical balls turn into digital balls on the screen, and they kind of bounce through this maze.
Oh, that's cool!
It's really really cool.
And is it pretty seamless, like that transition?
It is. It was flawless. It was really really well done. I think that was a French team that made that. I also played a game that I didn't write the name down, but it's kind of one of those, it's kind of like the Resistance or Werewolf or one of those games where you kind of have to deduce who the bad people are and who the good people are, where you were in an elevator with the same five or six people every day, and some people wanted to send you to the wrong floor, some people wanted to go to the right floor, and basically one person's job was to press the buttons on the elevator and then the game would tell you whether you had done well or not.
It was
really clever and really well done and kind of gave you that werewolf type game without having a mediator.
How about you, Norm? What did you and Jeremy end up doing half?
We went back and on Thursday and did a bunch of demos. So Valve had a whole, it wasn't a booth, but it was a whole room, almost a ballroom set up where they have many booths. And it wasn't for them to show off any of the things that they were working on, but really a space so that indie game developers could show off their games and get a lot of times throughout the week. So they would be, you know, on Wednesday or Thursday, certain hours, being able to set up their own appointments without having to buy booth space. And so we saw a lot of HTC Vive games. We kicked off the day with visiting Servios. They made Raw Data, which is a multiplayer, like horde mode robot killing game.
Yeah,
and their next game is not about robot killing and has a interesting new locomotion mechanic. It's called Sprint Vector. It's a racing game in VR, multiplayer racing game, and it combines like four different locomotion mechanics to get you to race, including moving your hands
like
forward up
jogging?
And down, like more like you're skating. Or your skiing.
Oh, okay.
Like cross-country skiing. So if, imagine if your hands, if the sticks, the HTC Vive controllers were the tops of ski poles, and you're moving them and pressing the button down, and then using it to propel yourself forward and ski. And then you can move left and right physically, because it's room scale. And then they combine that mechanic with jumping by pressing a button and vaulting yourself, which some games have done. Combining that with climbing, so there are obstacles for you to climb and vault yourself up and climb, and then also a flying mechanic where you hold your arms out and then fly. And so you combine all four of those at high speed in a race environment.
How was the comfort?
So after Jeremy used it, he said he definitely felt a little bit woozy. I felt like if I planted my feet down, it was a little bit of a catch-22 because I wanted to plant my feet down so that I would not get woozy. And once I hit my stride, it was really comfortable. It was really fun to move really quickly, especially running to a jump, to a vault, to a climbing, and then to a gliding. Those things were really natural. But then because it was room scale and there were parts of the map where they had obstacles that you had to literally duck under or sidestep as you're moving at the high speeds, that's where I didn't feel like it was perfectly done. And they kept it fairly linear, so it was always moving forward. You didn't have to turn and curve around.
Did it feel like you were doing parkour?
Yeah.
Okay.
It felt like the parkour, but like vaulting, like very much like a Spider-Man without the web slinging.
Oh, okay.
Where you're running really fast and you can grab onto a wall and then really launch yourself up in the air and then grab and launch. So like the things we loved about, for example, the Lone Echo Oculus demo with the lateral movement to climbing or even climby, but in this case, with gravity and moving very fast, like Windlands, but in a racing environment. And that was just a very early stage part of their game, so that they haven't said anything about release dates, but multiplayer for sure. That was a lot of fun.
I played one of the new Arizona Sunshine Horde map, which is set in a dark cave. You have to find a flashlight. It was very scary.
No.
Like the zombies were all up in my business, and they had unlimited ammo on, which I think was good for the demo and made me not wet my pants while I was playing, but it was scary and fun.
I can't handle any of the horror games right now.
I don't like horror games, it turns out. This is what I've realized about myself.
Well, that one, it was the loveliest show, and I did it as well. It was set in the dark. Mm-hmm. So you had to find the flashlight.
Yeah.
Use the flashlight, and it really lets you do the cop pose where you have the one hand with the flashlight out and then one hand with your pistol out. But it's best if you'd played it in multiplayer, I think.
Yeah.
And I don't think they had it set up for multiplayer.
That was the first time I got to use the new Vive head strap, though, which was terrific.
Yeah. Yeah, the Vive head strap at the Vive booth, at the Valve booth. It was all the headsets were with the Vive head strap, the new one, the deluxe audio strap, which is $100. The only thing it doesn't allow, I realized after a second time using it at GDC, is it doesn't let you tilt the screen, tilt the headset.
The Vive kind of doesn't ever let you tilt the screen,
right?
No,
because and only the Oculus does, because the Oculus has the screen. PSVR.
You can tilt it a little bit.
Lets you slide it forward and back, but doesn't.
Oh,
let you
right.
Tilt
I
up
guess
and
you.
Down.
I guess you tilt it by adjusting your head, the ring on your head.
Yeah, and the Oculus lets you tilt because it's on a spinning axis right there, and the Vive because it is still a strap, like it's not. It's more rigid, but it's still holding from the back, cupping from the bottom of the back of your head to the front of your face. It's comfortable. It doesn't let you adjust the angle of the screen to your eyes if you wanted to adjust that for focus reasons. I did get to use, though, the LG HMD prototype.
Wow.
And it was quite an adventure to try to
get. You guys put out a video on that already, right?
We did, yeah. And
was it set up in a hotel room or something someplace?
It was set up at a hotel room.
Okay.
Yeah. They had it at the Valve booth, but it was only for one day at the Valve booth. And then the day they weren't at the Valve booth, we had to find them at their hotel room. But ended up all working out. And it's super comfortable. And their big innovation really works. So
it's more like the Halo ring of the PSVR.
It looks exactly like the PSVR.
Huh.
Where it's the Halo ring in the back, where it's down to the knob that you turn to tighten it, and the button you press to stretch it out, to how it has that triangular pad that sits on your forehead. It's like, I don't want to say ripped off, but it's very heavily inspired to me. Felt like the PSVR.
That springiness was the thing that I kind of missed from the Vive one.
So that's comfortable. And once it's attached to the top of your forehead and the back of your head, then the visor, the actual screen itself, you could actually lift it up and down like a visor.
How much did it weigh compared to, say, a Vive? Could you tell?
They didn't let us do AB comparisons or tell us the weight.
Could you eyeball it?
It wasn't heavy.
It wasn't? Okay.
It wasn't heavy. It felt like PSVR in my hand or a Vive. It felt like a PSVR.
Okay.
How long did you have it on?
We did. They had a game demo for like a 10-minute game demo that I played.
Did you get to see their lighthouses at all or no?
Lighthouses are exactly the same.
Is it still two spinning gyros or is it just the one?
They wouldn't clarify. It looked like one to me.
It's impossible to tell, though.
From the front, I could barely tell. Same size. Their controllers are a little different. The controllers are actually a little more round. More rounded at the bottom of the handle, but angular in terms of where the sensors are.
Still not a definite, like a canonically correct way to hold that.
No.
Right. Okay.
And while it has more button parity than button parity with HTC Vive and one additional button, another system button, so developers can program that. And they relocated some of the buttons.
Does it have the grip in the same bad spot?
Yeah. Grip same. And then everything feels a little lower. Hmm. Like the trigger and the grip feel lower on this. Than on the Vive controller.
Same
the Vive controller, the trigger, two-stage trigger.
Yeah.
The Vive controller, the trigger feels closer to the donut.
Yeah.
Here it's lower on the handle, and it's a little more contoured, curved in the bottom. The thing that sucks for me is that they're designing it. It feels like designing it just like Vive did, HTC did, where the controller is paired to the headset.
Why is that bad?
So you can't mix and match.
Oh.
I would love for a future where you're able to mix and match, get the headset you want, the controllers you want, and have everything tied to maybe a USB, USB hub or something, as opposed to having to buy one closed system.
Well, okay, so having used the dev kits that had the controllers pairing to a dongle that was back plugged into the PC, the radio, you want the radio, having the radio really close to the receiver has real benefits.
Yeah, and there are definitely line of sight issues
yeah.
and signal issues that people have told me about with the USB dongles for these separate donut trackers.
Yeah, like you want to have, there's a reason there's a USB port on top of the Vive is my understanding for the donut trackers. It's interesting that you say that you'd like to mix and match. I can't imagine them ever selling those things independently of each other, except for in like an RMA type sense, because like you're not gonna be able to buy a Vive headset without the hands, ever, or a Steam VR headset without the hands.
Right.
I assume.
Right. But in the future, who's gonna make the new non-grip required clamp?
The hands.
The hand controllers, yeah. Like that Valve prototype. Like, is that gonna be? If is Valve going to do the same thing where they open source that design and then who's going to make that and how is that going to pair it with your headset?
If it's Bluetooth, it's just pairs, right? So if you have an LG LG headset and HTC, like right now you can hook two things up.
Is it just Bluetooth?
So the Vive, if you want to connect multiple Vive ones, you can use a Steam controller dongle to connect them, to connect another two, or at least one. I'm not sure about it. You might only be able to do one. I don't know. I mean, that's a weird. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff that's kind of unclear about how all this works.
Yeah. We'll talk more about VR and the games I saw in the VR minute. But the other big non-GDC news out this week is the new WikiLeaks.
Hold on. Did you talk about the Oculus? We didn't talk about the Oculus price drop last week, did we?
We did.
We did.
Oh, we did? Okay.
It happened as we were podcasting. Is when the price dropped $200.
And yeah. Robo, we'll talk about Robo Recall too.
Yeah,
so.
Yes.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay.
So WikiLeaks released 9,000 pages documents yesterday morning.
You mean Russia?
Yeah. Yes. The hacking arm of Russia.
WikiLeaks sponsored by RT.
Yeah.
That's right. It's a collection of what they say were CIA files showing how CIA hacks into phones and computers.
Guess what?
Their protocols. Yeah, guess what? We're all vulnerable if we do stupid things.
Dude, it's not if we do stupid things. It's if you have a TV, anything with a microphone. Mm-hmm. Like, this is all stuff that we knew. It's just nice to have somebody saying, hey.
That they're actually listening?
Yeah. I mean, we knew they were listening.
I was confused about one thing. Like, all the TVs listed, it was mostly Samsungs that I saw referenced,
they
right?
They did voice control. So they have microphones.
So your Xfinity X1 stuff, all that stuff that's unencrypted through.
Yeah, look, if you want to look at something that's easy to hack, a cable box where they're not great about security on the best of days is number one.
I can't wait for them to hack my Xfinity X1 voice commands. Where right. It's gonna be like, Food Network. Seriously, where is Food Network? My HGTV. Wife wants to watch Chopped. Food Network.
Yeah.
That's pretty much what that is.
Alexa, 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 Alexa.
What are you doing to our listeners?
Oh, sorry. Sorry, I forgot.
What are you doing?
I forget. Alexa, yeah, yeah.
So there are exploits they explicitly listed out for iOS and Android. Some of these are relatively old. They're not for iOS 10.
Yeah.
And none of it says that they have access to encrypted data. So if you have an app that does end-to-end encryption and you send data and do voice communication that way, it looks like from this release that stuff is still protected.
If they have ever had physical access to your hardware.
Oh, then yeah, of course. Then they can. Then
or your phone has been rooted, which is, yeah. It seems easier to do on Android than iOS still. That was the one of the takeaways I read. Then it's easy. Like if there's a low level root on the phone or low level hack on the phone, then they can get whatever you're typing into Signal or WhatsApp or whatever your app of choice is. Before it's encrypted. The encryption just protects you between the device and the recipient.
And most of the points of entry are just malicious websites.
Yeah.
So malicious websites that you browse on your Android phone that anytime you have those pop-ups.
Or iOS. Phishing. Yeah.
Or yeah, yeah.
Did you see that the Justice Department declined to continue prosecution on the child pornographers because they don't want to give up their Tor exploit?
Oh.
So they have a Tor exploit that they took over. I can't remember the name of the site, but it was the clearinghouse, darknet clearinghouse for child porn, and they took it over for like a week and harvested a bunch of IPs from people who were using Tor, and now don't want to tell, like they're not prosecuting because the judge was going to make them share the exploit basically.
Wow.
Yeah.
Does this information coming to light change any of? Do you think it changes Google or Apple's approach to security on their devices?
You
imagine they have in large teams already.
I think
aware of this.
Yeah.
This isn't new information to them. They've known about these sort of vulnerabilities for a while.
No, probably if they knew about the vulnerabilities, they would have fixed the vulnerabilities. Like when you're living in a world where 0 days that aren't known can fetch millions and millions of dollars on the black market, like this is obviously there are teams working on this. The question is Google or iOS going to take a serious effort at rebuilding the core parts of the OS to make it more difficult for these types of exploits to exist? And I can't imagine that they will.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We've had rumors of a full teardown and rebuild of Android that might be coming.
I mean, it's but Comey was on the FBI director. Comey did a interview the other day at a conference where he basically said, look, we have to work closely. We have to stop the Apple versus FBI, Google versus FBI stuff and figure out a way to work at the same time that this CIA stuff leaked and basically said, look, if there are keys to these devices, he said in the context of we seized 12,000 phones or something, and of them, like a significant percentage were completely unable to get data off of. The upshot is we can't trust the federal government with backdoors to our devices. But I mean, maybe there's some sort of happy. I don't know what the happy medium is. Actually,
and really, hopefully, this awareness of this should encourage users to update the software on their phone.
Yeah, like if you get an iOS, if your phone says, "Hey, you have a system level update, you should install it." You should install it. Don't let that stuff sit. It's not, you know, the Windows 10, as annoying as the Windows 10. Hey, we're updating your machine without you asking us to, and by the way, you're not going to work for the next hour. It's probably the right choice.
Yeah. Still developing.
Also, don't install software that you don't know where it comes from. Don't install weird hacked third-party drivers that come with stuff like daemon tools. Don't install, don't use ad blockers. Sorry, guys, I know that ads are important, but like ad blocking networks that serve third-party injection malware is the only way that we stop that from happening. Like it's a fucked up place that we're in. That the web is a model that exists, like the economics of the web mean that users have to allow sites to run arbitrary code on their computers.
And beyond those like kind of basic things, are you going to change your behavior at all based off of the information that was leaked?
I've been thinking about moving to a cabin for a while, so I don't know. Mm-hmm. I kind of always assume that they're listening.
Put tape over your microphones and
then
covers.
It's just muffled. That doesn't block.
Or your cameras. Tape over your cameras.
Just put a
covers.
White noise generator right by the microphones.
Yeah, your Oculus cameras are watching you. Glorious infrared.
Pig Latin in all of your microphone devices. That's how you're.
Yeah. Hey, I had a dead Oculus camera. That's why I was getting judder when I was testing, by the way. What? So I had an Oculus camera that when I reinstalled Windows the other day, it gave me the, hey, this camera's, you're getting bad signal from this camera. I tried it in all my USB ports, mm-hmm. and when I replaced it with another camera, everything was fine.
Oh, wow. Well, so, good thing those cameras are only $60 now.
I just called them and said, hey, this camera's broken. Please send me a new one.
Good.
I haven't heard back yet.
Oh, okay. Last few bits of technology news. You know, this isn't really interesting news, but I wanted to use it as a starting point. Microsoft has teamed up with this company, Steelcase, that makes furniture, and they're designing like work environments that they think would best be suited for creatives and the working lifestyle. And it's a lot of, you know, high concept BS. But the reason I want to talk about this is, do you guys think that at some point Apple will make furniture?
Well, hold on. First, Steelcase makes really good chairs. Like, they make good office furniture. They're right up there with Herman Miller and, mm-hmm. and kind of the other premier fancy, well-designed, comfortable, long-lasting. If you want to spend $1,000 on a chair that's going to last you two decades, Steelcase is one of the companies to go to.
Great.
I thought that this was a pretty Apple-y move. Like I thought this looked like something that Jobs would have done. It reminded me a lot of the hints that we saw of the Apple stores before the Apple stores happen. I don't think that Apple's going to make furniture. But I think Apple will partner with somebody that makes furniture for sure.
Yeah, that's 100% what I think.
I feel like Apple really wants, I feel like Johnny Ives would love to design furniture.
I think Johnny Ives will partner, I think Apple will partner with somebody and Johnny Ives will, the Apple line designed by Johnny Ives is a thing that will happen. But making furniture is way outside their core competency in terms of like manufacturing and logistics and all that stuff. And none of the stuff that they can bring to bear on a logistics supply chain is going to help them with furniture.
Absolutely correct. The other thing is like the stores aren't optimized for that either. I don't think that's an easy switch. Yeah, their showrooms aren't.
I think the reason I think it's going to happen is I think as we move toward Apple wanting everything to be wireless, they have to build desks and the side tables with the wireless charger.
Do people actually want shit to be wireless though?
It doesn't matter. That's what Apple wants and that's what Apple thinks you want.
I'd be okay with
wireless.
Think of all
the things. I mean, we're getting close to right now the only reason you want to plug something, the only reason you need to plug something in is for power.
I mean, look, the only reason we're still in that situation is because Apple doesn't want to pay into one of the standards that exists now.
I thought they signed on for the Qi.
I didn't know
standard.
That.
They did.
Yeah. Okay.
They did.
So then guess what? We're all going to put cheap heads on our desktop.
And I think I don't know if that's an elegant solution. I think third parties will sell these cheap heads. I think Apple wants you to have maybe a side table like your nightstand or your office table that's going to be put your phone anywhere on the table, put your laptop anywhere on the table, and you just don't think about it.
The consumer product diversity on furniture makes consumer electronics look really easy, right? Like there are an infinity of different furniture styles that people want. Some people like antiques, and you're not gonna get an Apple branded antique nightstand.
That choice is exactly what Apple loves to fight against, though. There is no choice when it comes to the things that people just want the Apple thing.
But furniture is a different thing.
Are we sure about that?
It's like clothes.
We think that's like cars too. But you know what? Love the Teslas.
I don't think that's like cars. I think cars, people buy, there are multiple different kinds of consumers for cars, but most people buy one nightstand for a really, really long time. It's not a market Apple.
I still don't think the tech is there for the charging to be at the rate that it needs to be, which is like the underlying assumption there, right? That we can get it there where it can charge fast enough where this will be.
But if it's everywhere, then it doesn't matter. If every surface is a charging surface, then as long as it's not in your pocket, where does everyone put their phones and their laptops? Not in their skinny jeans. It's
I
on
rest
the table.
It on my groin usually.
We have all our devices on our table right now.
I look, the penalty for making a bad furniture, like you need, if they release Qi 2 or Qi 3, you're not going to replace your nightstand. And Apple's not going to make some weird modular solution. You just jam a thing in there.
They'll wait to make you buy a new one.
But that's insane. If Apple partners with anybody, it'll be with IKEA, probably.
No, it'd be Herman Miller.
No.
I think
there
high
is
end.
DWR. Zero.
High-end.
Zero chance it's going to be IKEA. Zero.
It would be high end.
Apple will not handle, is not okay with the term wobble being associated to their product.
Well, that's true. Design within reach is probably who they partner with. Although that brand, they've tanked that brand in the last few years.
I think that's just a reseller. They just
that's the problem. Is it's not a reseller anymore. They make their own. They make their own knockoff furniture now.
Yeah, I mean it. I could totally see starting simple, the one side table, then the one nightstand. Apple Johnny Ive designed nightstand. Put your phone here. Put your watch there. Don't need cables. Sell for $1,000, people are going to eat that up.
A lot of the appeal of Apple, though, is that you can buy the expensive one. You'll notice that they didn't really do an edition watch on the second version of the Apple Watch.
Well, no, a lot of appeal to Apple for their target consumers, the rich people, is that it is expensive.
But my point is, if you're a poor person and have an iPhone 7 and you're a rich person and have an iPhone 7, it's the same iPhone 7, right? The hardware is essentially identical.
And the only way that worked, even though it's $800 piece of hardware, mm-hmm. is because of cellular subsidies and now leasing plans mm-hmm. that everyone does.
Yeah.
And you can't do that with furniture, but you also can't do that on MacBooks.
You can do that with furniture. There's a whole massive cottage industry in screwing people on short-term furniture loans.
You don't think there'd be a stopgap of like the work surface, like a pad?
I think that's the super inelegant solution.
I know it's inelegant.
That's for Belkin and that's for a Logitech to make. That's not for Apple to want to sell you. They don't want to sell you the $100 pad. Yeah, the $100 pad, that's going to work fine with everyone's iPhone 8 or iPhone 10, whatever it is. But they want to sell the $1,000 side table and make the margin on that. It costs them maybe $100 to make and has the same built-in wireless technology, but the no-brainer, designed by Apple, designed in California, made by Apple.
Here's the thing about a $1,000 end table is it will cost $100 to ship, right? Like all of their margins, all of their being able to make stuff in China and put it on airplanes and fly it over here by the thousands goes away with furniture. Yeah. So they'll partner with somebody. They'll have a certification thing that uses their own specific language, just like the headphones, just like the iPhone accessories. But they have to put something in the box that you can charge the phone with if they take away the charging port.
I think my bigger point here is, regardless of who does it, this is something that I think we're all going to move toward, where the charging infrastructure...
Is it really that big of an inconvenience? I think it's much more likely that we'll have glass-based batteries that last 2 weeks instead of a day, and we'll charge it every 2 weeks, and it's a less frequent thing that we have to dick around with.
It could be both.
I mean, that perfect world is that we never have to think about it again, and it just takes
not
body
not having
from
to
our
think
pants.
About it. Never underestimate the power of convenience.
If the CIA could just improve, with their hacks, actually deal with some of these battery issues.
You saw the lithium ion guy had another, there's a new,
the glass thing. Yeah. Yeah, there isn't much to say about it at this point.
It's like every new battery technology that's 5 years off, right?
Mm-hmm. 5 years is we don't know when this is going to be done.
All right. One last bit of news. Update to Lightroom Mobile will now do raw photo capture with HDR on your mobile devices.
I know they announced this a while ago. Have you actually done this yet? Actually,
I have not. I'm going to get this update and test it out. I haven't had the most success with Lightroom on iOS importing my raw photos and being able to tweak them.
Why?
It's
slow?
No, it just ends up working off the JPEG. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
So, well, that's the opposite of this whole thing, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
All right. Are we ready to go to our next segment?
Yeah. Let's do it. Before we jump to our next segment, I do want to thank the sponsor of this week's episode. This episode of This Is Only a Test is brought to you by Crizal No Glare Lenses. If you wear glasses, then you know that fingerprints, smudges, scratches, and glares can obstruct your vision and be a huge distraction. Sometimes you end up focusing more on what's in your glasses than what's going on around you, but not anymore thanks to Crizal No Glare Lenses. Crizal lenses offer resistance to blemishes, giving you the clearest vision possible. And that means no more fingerprint smudges on your glasses from taking it off or scratches from cleaning your lenses on your shirt. And because Crizal No Glare Lenses stay clear and reduce distracting glare, your friends and family can actually see your eyes, not your glasses. Look better, feel better, and more importantly, stay more immersed in the world around you, not just your lenses. Go to crizal.com, crizal.com, and start living life in the clear. And thank them for sponsoring this week's episode.
Now it's time for a moment of science. All right, give me that goddamn Zelda cartridge.
All right, here we go. I've closed out my game, so it won't ruin the save. Here's the cartridge. All now, right. I licked the 1-2 Switch cartridge, so this is clean.
Oh, it's not. It's a non-licked cartridge?
Non-licked cartridge. Kishore is going to take the Zelda cartridge.
You got to get full contact, Kishore. Just rest it on there.
Mm-hmm.
No, don't just put it flat on your tongue.
No, you want the other side, right?
This side has plenty of bitter agent.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's all awful.
All right, I'm going to clean that cartridge
take
for you later.
Swig that Diet Coke.
Wow, that's... Oh, God, damn it!
It kind of builds over time. The Coke doesn't make it... It just makes it worse.
Yeah, this is the fun. The denatonium benzoate, bittering agent that's now on... these cartridges everywhere. Actually, this bittering agent's in a lot of places. Like, it's in soap. Have you ever tried to eat your liquid soap at home?
Why would you do that?
I don't recommend
it. Bad idea.
But this stuff is in there. It's in...
it's in, hand sanitizer, right?
Yeah, it's in any alcohol-based thing, like isopropyl alcohol and stuff. It's actually a really useful thing to have around. And some companies are using a variant of this chemical to actually help control appetite. Mm. Like, you could take a... end of meal type pill or like little amuse, if you will, and it'll just spread this bitter flavor and just make you not want to eat.
You could also put it on the fork, like with another layer of stuff on top of it, that when you when your saliva eats it away enough, eventually the fork just tastes awful.
Here's the thing that's sort of funny, and this is one of my favorite NIH studies. It's pretty old, but in 91, this bittering agent has been around forever. It's the most bitter compound known to man. In 91, they did an analysis with kids to see how much of this bittering agent, if it was placed inside of a liquid, will it actually stop people from doing that? And out of 30 people that were participating in the trial, wait, you're putting that back in there without de-liquifying it?
It's fine. I'm not going to lick it.
They put
germs are fine.
They put this in orange juice, and
drank the orange juice. They thought it was like
it was part of an experiment. But even though it was in the orange juice, 7 out of the 30 took multiple sips. So
it's extra fresh. Oh, it's a bitter batch of oranges. That's all right. Does it wipe off on your hand when you
No.
No.
Well, wait. It's pretty.
Yep. There it
yep.
is.
Yeah. Yeah.
No. Not really.
Okay.
It's not too bad, and it's also it comes off it with soap and water. It's not that pervasive. This has been around forever. Yeah. I know it's making all the rounds. It's not that new.
Thanks, Internet.
All right. Two studies this week, or two really short stories. One is: was your grandfather's either of your grandfathers? Were they bald or balding?
I only know one of my grandfathers, and relatively full head of hair.
Both of my grandfathers had pronounced widow's peaks.
Oh.
Yeah.
That, well.
Like full back. It's shocking.
Like Adam's family level?
Not quite.
But no tip.
Oh, Munster. That's what
they didn't have the point, but they had the high. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There's a new study out this week about male pattern baldness, and this is what's called a GWAS study, which is a large genomic study, and it was done where they took data from genomic data from 10,000 mostly white people cases from Europe and like analyzed the data to see if they could find different genetic risk factors. And when they're examining people that had male pattern baldness, they found they had elevated risk for prostate cancer, cardiac arrest, and a few neurodegenerative disorders.
Oh, no.
Is this a correlation?
Oh, it's always a correlation. Yeah, not causal. Like, bald people aren't.
It's just because they're not as active and having as much sex.
I think it's just, like, all that rejection as being a bald person, yeah. Like, really, wow. Really hits your heart.
The Costanza effect.
I don't know, but one of the side effects of having prostate cancer is in a large prostate and, in some cases, in a large penis. So I don't know how that goes together with what we were saying earlier.
You take the good and you take the bad.
All right. You take them all, and there you have the facts of life. So congratulations to our male listeners who have grandfathers that have balding.
Congratulations, guys.
Last one real quick is about origami. Either of you origami fans?
I appreciate the art.
Did you fold cranes for your wedding, Norm?
No, we didn't have any cranes.
Wait, you were at that wedding.
I just wondered if I got screwed out of the cranes.
No, there were no cranes.
I thought they were just for the specials.
Cranes. Absolutely no cranes.
There is a new form of origami that scientists made out of polystyrene, basically like styrofoam. And they've used light, a particular color of light, as this, sheets of this really thin polystyrene were made. And the light actually could cause the polystyrene to fold.
Is this what you use in the kind of polystyrene you use in a vacuum former or something like that?
It's a lot thinner. Okay. So similar, though. Basically the same material. Just
stretched thinner.
Yeah, there's like these little lines of ink with different sort of colors on it. And so when they shine a particular type of light, it would basically interact with that color and cause like a slight tension. So that would pull on the polystyrene and cause it to fold. There's this incredible video.
Now, is it energy in the intensity of light or a specific wavelength?
Yeah, there's a certain color of light that's reacting to on the polystyrene.
What is happening there?
Origami is folding itself, Norm.
Well,
I
know
science.
That. But what is actually happening? Why that wavelength? What is it affecting?
I mean, it's putting energy into that. Like there's some absorption of energy with that.
So it's breaking or creating chemical bonds, right? Presumably,
I don't think it's breaking the chemical bonds, but I think it's actually imparting a little bit of heat to the polystyrene, and that heat causes it, because it's so thin and it has these sort of, I think, folds in it.
Yeah.
It causes that energy to to be translated into motion.
That's really cool.
It's a, it's pretty amazing what they're able to achieve with this. What's the application, you say? None.
Can you build a house with origami?
It's just cool.
Oh.
It. I'll post the video. It's a pretty amazing video. Probably my favorite.
Are they using UV? Is that what?
Yeah, it looks like some form of UV light.
Did you see the pink water in Canada?
Why is there pink water in Canada? Is it to celebrate Day Without Women? They turned all their water pink.
No, they didn't do it on purpose. It's Onaway, Canada. Got a surprise on Monday when the town's tap water started turning pink, and eventually it looked like Ghostbusters 2 slime.
That is pink.
Yeah, it's pink ass pink.
Wow, it's Ghostbusters 2. Totally.
Yeah, they. There was a valve malfunction at the town's water treatment plant, so potassium permanganate.
Oh, potassium permanganate.
Yeah.
If you mix that with glycerol, it's my favorite reaction. It's a self-igniting reaction, and if you put it in a controlled vessel, you can get quite the explosion.
What?
So you just, potassium. Hold on. Did you just tell this is only a test listeners how to make a bomb?
No, I did not.
Okay.
I told them how to do a safe reaction at home. Actually, the funny thing about potassium permanganate and glycerol, they used to sell it at the PBS store.
Oh,
do you remember PBS stores?
No.
They showed up in the malls in like the mid-90s.
It was like the precursor of Brains or one of those like smart people stores.
Exactly. And I remember walking in and seeing like they're selling a vial of potassium permanganate, which is these, it's just a silvery flake type material. And glycerol, I'm like, I know that reaction. That is an incredibly powerful reaction. And PBS should not be selling this in stores. It was gone about a month later, but I had bought all the stock.
You used to be able to buy a bunch of really dangerous stuff in chemistry sets back before the nanny state took charge.
I know. Thanks, Norm. I'm blaming it on his
generation.
My favorite thing about potassium permanganate is that you can neutralize it with vitamin C. And I know that because in our high school, one of the senior pranks was somebody from our chemistry class colored our entire pool a pink purple color. It actually turns deep purple. It's just low concentration there probably is why it looks pink.
So yeah, they said they forgot, they flushed some water treatment lines and they used it to remove iron and manganese.
Yeah. Awesome.
But the valve stayed open and it actually got into the water supply. They said don't worry about it.
It's not that harmful.
It's not bad.
A little ascorbic acid and all be fine.
Yeah.
All right. Time for you guys to shine.
All right, our last segment.
The VR Minute, virtual reality this week.
There are three games that we saw at GDC that I won't give a shout out to, and we're going to have like videos and interviews with most of these. One is Kiss or Kill, which was made in, it's a Vive game. The developers made it in about 2 weeks' time, and it's a game show in VR.
Is this Fuck, Marry, Kill the VR game?
It's not. Very interesting because Jeremy and I played it. It's very, very much a standard game show where we chose our avatar. We both looked like Ryu from Street Fighter. And you had a button and in front of you, and then there was a host that asked you questions and presented questions. And it was in like a virtual set. The host was played by a third person down in LA.
Oh,
so
really?
So it was a multiplayer experience, and they had someone with a script. And it was really weird because the moment Jeremy and I got into the game, like we heard the host say, "What's your name, player one?" And I thought it was just AI, so it didn't respond verbally. And it turned out it was a real person. And then they had their script. It was a really delightful host. And we answered trivia questions. And like the novel thing for them is that at some point you get like a weapon so you can like bash your opponent so to make them dizzy so they can't read the question. But they made it in 2 weeks. So for what they made, pretty neat.
What is the kiss part?
At the very end of the game, the winner of the game can choose either kiss or kill the opponent. And if you kiss, you have to virtually kiss them, I guess. We chose kill, which then puts you in a boxing match. I don't know.
I feel like you missed a real opportunity for some internet.
Tells a lot about your relationship with Jeremy.
We chose kill.
Sorry, Jeremy.
What I thought was interesting was their plan for this is to make the host not an actual real person when they're released, but to tie it into IBM Watson and have it be AI driven.
Wow. What, like, and Watson, that's some like serious juice.
Yeah, and I'm not exactly sure what would the benefits of Watson be, because they would still pre-script the questions.
Well, they wouldn't have to pay somebody to be there answering the...
But why would you need a database accessing tool like Watson?
Oh, I think they're probably using Watson for the natural language interface.
That's probably it.
Yeah.
To parse the answers and to choose that.
Yeah, there's... I mean... It's interesting that the machine learning stuff is happening at the same time as VR, because it means that there's a lot of interesting opportunities for weird stuff to happen.
And just the social, I mean, we know social is great in VR. I'm unconvinced that having an AI, you know, with a Siri-like voice prompt you is going to give you that type of fun interaction.
I mean, did you feel like it was... good with the real human being?
It was pretty good with the real. They would call back to earlier things. You know, it was someone who had experienced doing this type of performance before. But I guess if it was more like You Don't Know Jack,
yeah,
then that would be fun. If it was like You Don't Know Jack style asking questions, but with like a lot of scripting, so like big Excel sheets with all the possible answers, and using the Watson part of it to decipher the responses and to maybe store some information, that, you know, you want some interactivity.
Like,
where are you from?
Yeah. Well, and it lets you give answers that are vague, but or it lets you ask questions that have multiple correct answers that can have some nuance, right? So, like, if you think about, you know, what's your favorite? I don't know. Let's see. Most trivia is not set up in a way to answer those kinds of questions, right? You usually say, what's a 1954 movie starring Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall? And the answer is always probably Key Largo. I don't know. I was like, wait, it's suddenly, I was like, Casablanca isn't Lauren Bacall. That's not
no,
right.
No. It's
Key Largo is Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall.
I'm thinking of the other movie.
You're thinking about Maltese Falcon?
No.
Dark Passage.
Dark,
possibly.
Yeah.
The Big Sleep.
Big Sleep.
Big Sleep. Big Sleep. Yeah, the Sleep. Raymond Chandler one.
Yes, yes.
And that was 1946 or 48 or something, not 54.
But yeah.
The point is, you can ask questions that have non-specific answers, mm-hmm. but that the machine can still judge as correct or incorrect.
So I'm curious if they're planning on using any of this Watson stuff, and if Watson is any good at recognizing, or if they can even program this in, gesture recognition. Like, people make very standard gestures when they shrug, and if you can build in IK models, so you know that you can assume that a contestant is, you know, either they're hitting the button, right, and that's an active thing, or if they're making like I don't know, or they're doing a thinking pose, like to have the AI react to that appropriately, that's where there's a lot of nonverbal communication that could be interesting in VR as well.
Or it could be like put your hand on your head, even stuff like that, right? That's
right.
Hard for the machine to recognize.
Right. The two other games, one, Cloudgate Studios has, they have an Island 359, like a dinosaur hunting game, like a very Jurassic Park-like game, but they were demoing it with motion trackers that they put on their feet. So they put the Vive trackers, the additional pucks, and...
How is it on their feet? Like on their shoe somehow?
So they had a mount that you want to put one on your back of your belt, behind you on your belt buckle, and then two on your shoelaces and tied your shoelaces real tight. And then that gives you with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 points of tracking, mm-hmm. two hands, one head, one hip, and 2 feet, they're able to do a pretty good virtual avatar, which for the purpose of the game, it didn't seem like it had a ton of benefit because you're still teleporting around. You're not like where your feet are planted doesn't have a real effect on the gameplay. You can kick dinosaurs. That's what you could do, right?
Yeah.
And that's fun. For them, it was more about having a better sense of self in the game. And that's the interesting thing. Do you need, how much of a physical avatar do you need? And is there a point? Because we know just seeing our hands, like you have floating hands, that's the incredible sense of self already. You don't need to see elbows for it to work. But if you could see your hands and your feet and they modeled your hips, it increasingly gives you more presence. But is there a point where then it becomes an uncanny valley of presence where You don't want to see that because too many things don't work.
That's it. You and I played that thing at Swiss Next years ago where you could see your elbows and the elbows didn't line up with your sense of proprioception, and it's really uncomfortable. And like, we've tested that. Some people really respond worse to that than others. The idea that people are going to buy foot controllers to put on that are not standard out of the box is, I think, really optimistic.
Well,
I still don't see the advantage of the foot
control. You can kick stuff.
No, I understand that. But I mean, like, I've hardly, since having touch or anything, like hand tracking, looked down at my feet and said, I wish there was.
Then you can do
what
things.
You're doing.
Yeah. Right. You can do also things like, once you model the feet, you can do collision detection where you can play a stealth game where your virtual body is and affects, like, moving, ruffling the leaves around a tree if you're trying to hide. Or if you're not designing a big open world game, you're designing a puzzle room, the placement of your feet, you have Indiana Jones style stepping on panels.
Or even if you're thinking, like, the hips are another big one. Like, if you're thinking about something like Space Pirate Trainer, if you know, basically having head and hands doesn't give you enough data to reliably guess what the orientation of somebody's pelvis is and their shoulders are. So, like, you frequently will get, it errs on the side of conservatism, and when it detects where a hit is, it's guessing based on the triangle of where your head and hands are. So if it has more data, then you're going to get more reliable collision. In the real world, most of that stuff works pretty well without having to have the real data. So one of the things that we have when we did the Adult Swim thing, where we animated Carl from Aqua Teen, basically the performer, the first thing he tried to do was do one of the traditional Carl kicks, and we had no way to track that. So, like, I think it's much more interesting for people who are doing weird one-off special case stuff like what we do. Then I don't expect normal people to buy Vive trackers to track their feet in games.
And the software needs to be scalable. You need to be able to design a game with, like, Unseen Diplomacy, where you can play with just what the standard minimum set is, hand track controllers and head, but it could scale up with one additional tracker. You get the hips, that's important, or if you have two additional trackers, then maybe the legs, and that unlocks different types of gameplay. But it needs to be scalable where the game's going to work with you if you just have 3 points or 6 points. And I think it's fair to assume that once these Vive trackers come out, you know, on the high end, people are going to buy one at least.
I don't really. What do you think you're going to use it for?
Accessories, like guns.
Okay, swords. Okay, guns. Well, you already have a sword controller, for all intents and purposes.
Sure.
I think a lot of people will buy them for mixed reality.
Yep.
Because that's a much easier way to track the camera than jamming an extra Vive controller on there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I don't. My assumption is that, like, less than 10% of the market's going to buy these.
That would be really unfortunate. I think developers should not. I hope this is not a chicken and egg scenario where developers are going to resist developing for having something novel, a third thing tracked, even if it's not something you hold or something that's part of your body. Because I think there's a lot of potential there for having new types of experiences.
Min spec is so important on this kind of stuff, and the fact that the Vive comes with the two hands is the thing that makes the Vive work in a lot of cases.
Isn't it also $100? Right,
it's $100.
That's really where I see the problem. If these were like $25 or $50 bucks, then I would.
That's the thing where I thought it would be. I was hoping for 50.
And when you're looking at what $700 for Oculus and Touch with two cameras versus.
$600.
Oh, they dropped the price on the Vive now?
No, $600 for Oculus and two.
Oh, I thought it was $699. It's $599?
It's $599.
Okay, so $599 for that versus $699 for the, or $799 for the Vive.
Yeah.
It's plus another $100. That's bananas. Nobody's gonna buy that.
With the head strap too. You wanna get that comfort.
Well, once they run out of the old head straps, the head strap will be bundled in, I'm sure.
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
I think revenue streams for HTC.
I mean, it is nice that HTC is making money again.
Like, I think they need people who bought Vives last year, however many hundreds of thousands, to buy something this year.
I mean,
is
second Vive, gen, it'll be bundled, I think.
Is
I
would the hope HTC so. Tracker a Vive thing, or is it a CBR thing? Okay.
Yeah, HTC makes that and sells that.
Okay.
Yeah. And then the last thing, we'll talk about more straightforward game. We saw from the people who made Hover Junkers. Their new game is called Duck Season, and this is awesome. It's a two-hour...
Rabbit Season.
It's Duck Season.
Oh, okay. Is it that game?
It's a story-based game set in the 80s. It's set in the Stranger Things time, basically, where you play Duck Hunt. Your mom got you a game console, rented you Duck Hunt for a day, and you play Duck Hunt, and then, but things get weird.
Okay.
And the when you play the Duck Hunt, you're not just staring at TV shooting, you're actually inside the TV with a shotgun shooting the ducks.
So you're basically telling me
and it's all story
that
driven.
Some VR developer made a game exclusively for Jeremy Williams. Like this touches
basically.
On like
yeah.
his
Jeremy,
nostalgia.
Jeremy freaked out and loved it.
Yeah. That sounds right.
And it's all story based, designed to be a short, like a movie length experience. Mm-hmm. And as you play throughout the day, so the story is you have Duck Hunt, their duck season, for a day, 12-hour day, before your mom has to return it. And so you play it for 12, you play it for like 12 missions. And every time you play something else, things start to change.
Do you have a real dog?
You don't have a real dog.
So the dog isn't there?
The dog is there.
Oh.
Like you don't have a pet dog, but there is a dog in there.
All right. I'm going to stop reading.
You got to stop reading. It gets surreal.
Is it out soon?
It's out in a couple months.
Okay.
Yeah. I think they're able to have multiple ideas and do short-term development cycles and make games in 6 to 8 months.
I mean, that's kind of the key. With the VR developers I talked to at GDC, most people are leaning away from giant monolithic, you know, 2-year games and focusing on things that they can crank out and sell for 10 or 15 bucks.
Yeah, and if they do enough of those, by the time VR becomes more mainstream and more mass market, then they'll have a whole library of essentially indie games that have, and they'll be experienced enough to make something and spend the effort to do a 2-year development game.
Do you guys know about OpenVR Advanced Settings, the plugin?
No.
So I was at Upload and was shooting something in their mixed reality thing a few days ago, and they had this thing set up, and it basically lets you adjust chaperone boundaries, reset the floor, all of that stuff from inside the headset.
Oh,
that's
or
great.
While it's running. Yeah. Like, so when your shit gets out of whack, it lets you fix it really quickly and gives you really, really fine control over all of that stuff.
That's awesome.
Super duper good. You download from GitHub. I literally cannot recommend it highly enough.
And this is an application that you launch it in Steam VR while you're wearing the headset.
So you can, like, they were running it on the desktop because I was in the headset and they were changing, like, we were adjusting the chaperone boundaries to let me get to places in the world that we were showing that I wouldn't have been able to, like, when we were doing the stage show, for example.
Mm-hmm, sure.
And we had to keep redoing the chaperone until it lined up right with the world, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So it lets you change the orientation of the world inside chaperone inside the world and all that. Like, it's a super, super handy thing, especially if you're doing the kind of weird shit that we end up doing in VR a lot where you're demoing unusual things.
Well, that's great. And it just pops up next to the settings icon in Steam VR once you're in the headset.
I think it uses that plugin architecture that the Vive Port stuff uses. But I'm not 100% on that.
And it even has a Revive settings menu.
Yeah, it's
and
really good.
And you can toggle reprojection. It's great.
Yeah.
Really good. Really quickly, Superhot announced they're going to have a new update in a couple weeks.
I think it's out. Isn't it out?
I'm not sure when it's out, but it's like more replayability, difficult modes, you know.
Which is one of my favorite VR games, so I'm excited to see that.
I think I saw it on the Oculus store last night. Hold on, let's see. There was a thing that said Superhot.
Yeah, Superhot VR Forever
update.
Oh, the Forever update's out.
Yeah.
Oh, there it is.
There you go. You can play modes where only headshots will work. You can try to complete a game without shooting.
I think that seems straightforward.
Yep.
Grab those bullets.
And you know, hardcore modes, faster enemies, and a mode where you see if you can beat the entire game in less than 10 minutes.
Oh god.
I know. I would hope for more levels eventually. One last thing before we close out the podcast, Robo Recall, available and free. You guys been playing it?
It's out. Yeah, I have played a lot of Robo Recall.
What do you think?
It's really, really neat. Like it has the same, it's like playing that in one of the shooting galleries that is kind of prevalent on Steam makes you really understand the difference between people who make games and a shooting gallery.
There's a level of polish in Robo Recall that's where the money went, and the assets and the polish. Fundamentally, the game is simple. You're shooting robots, teleporting around, throwing them in the portals, tearing them apart, but everything is very, very satisfying.
It's
from the weapon upgrades to just the feeling of the recoil.
Really fast.
It's very, very fast. You can get good at it. Mm-hmm. It's a game where it feels like you can actually get good at it by having better aim or being creative with the way you dispatch the robots.
Well, and that's the interesting thing. Like I reached out to try to grab a gun from a robot's hand yesterday, like you would in Super Hot, actually. And I accidentally ripped his arm off. I was like, oh, right. I could just rip all their arms off and beat them to death with their arms.
Mm-hmm.
And that totally works. Stuff like the reload mechanism. You know, you can't reload the guns by default. The way you reload is by throwing a gun at a robot, bouncing it off, and catching it when it comes back to you.
Mm-hmm.
It's super. It's really neat.
Really, really satisfying. Quite a bit of game. Different big maps.
Yeah.
Time, day changes. And
it's free for touch users.
Free for touch users. Otherwise, I think $30. I want to say, $30 or $40. And then it's has mod support. And I haven't tried mods yet.
Are there mods yet?
There are.
It's like mutators.
I want to say it's mutators. I don't know if people can put more levels in, but like everything, they're giving all the assets out if you buy the game to make more.
$30 seems like a little bit much. It's basically 9 levels.
Yeah.
It's arcadey, so you can go back. There's replayability, and you unlock weapon upgrades and things like that. It has a star system, kind of like mobile, like Angry Birds type games, where you have to getting stars unlocks new weapon upgrades, and eventually you get the ability to like get multiply score and stuff like that. It's something I if I want to kill 5 minutes, then I am frequently will load that up.
Mm. All right, and that does it for us this week. For this and only a test, Will, what's the latest with Foo?
I'm not logged into Slack right now, but I'm waiting on the build that fixes the last bug.
Oh, wow. That means it'll be out.
So there'll be an episode on Steam. We're recording this on Wednesday. By the time you hear this on Thursday, it should be up. If everything goes well, it's the Quadrilateral Cowboy episode where I talked to Brendan Chung about his cyberpunk masterpiece, Quadrilateral Cowboy. It's a game about virtual reality hacking that you play on a monitor. So it's fun to talk about it in VR. And we also talk about game design choices involving toilets for a fairly extended period of time.
This awesome. Is the one you recorded live.
This is the one we recorded live at XOXO.
Awesome.
We're recording the next episode, I think next weekend is the current plan. Nice. And that's going to be something a little different. It's not going to be a game. It's with somebody you introduced me to, actually, Kishore. Mm-hmm.
I'm deeply excited about that science-related one. I can say that, right? It's science-related.
Yeah, but I mean, it's too late to not say it now. So,
I'm editing that out.
It gives you a new way to look at something that's normally intangible.
Very cool.
We will not be here next week.
Nor that's right. We're not going to be here.
Well, you could be here next week.
Yeah.
Are you paying me?
I'm going to see if Jerry probably won't even be here either. We will not have an episode.
Why don't we do one?
We can talk about where
we're going.
Yeah. Kishore and I are going to Switzerland next week.
Oi! Wait, no, that's not
no,
right.
That's no, the wrong.
That's Austria.
Yeah. No.
Oh.
We are visiting CERN and the Large Hadron Collider, one of the detectors there. Yes, Simone and Kishore are going. We're going to film some special episodes, and we are hopefully going to come back with some cool stuff. It's a very short trip. We're going to be back.
Is it on this time, or is it off again?
No, it's offline. If it's on, then you can't really
I was
going to
say, are you
going to
go downstairs and get superpowers or anything?
I don't know.
Yeah.
No, there's really not enough energy down there, even if you're hit with those collisions to do.
Oh.
That's not much good for yourself.
Okay. Well, I mean, I always wanted superpowers.
Mm-hmm. I think we're going to do a slightly different visit than you guys did the first time around.
Okay.
So it should be
fun. So we'll hopefully do a podcast maybe remotely next week. But until then, thank you, Will, for joining this week. You can always find Will at Will Smith on all the social medias. And check out Foo, foovr.com. And if you have Steam VR, it's there right now. It will work if you have Oculus Touch or the HTC Vive.
And the 2D client will be coming soon. So if you wanted an Oculus Home Key, if you backed the Kickstarter, you wanted an Oculus Home Key, we sent Steam keys to everybody. So we're sending Oculus Home keys to everybody too when that build is ready. So
very
everybody
cool.
gets everything.
Awesome. Kishore, anything else from you?
No. My science podcast. Oh, I have an episode coming up with one of the Virginia Tech scientists who went up to Flint and validated the lead level findings, which was a hard show to get through, but it was amazing. well worth a listen. It'll be out, I think, in 2 weeks.
Cool.
Very cool. All right, then. And you can find me at Enchan. All our content at Tested.com on the YouTubes and on our website. We have a lot of stuff going on for the premium community members. Simone, Sean, and I guess Joel, the 3D printer guy, built a Prusa 3D printer. That's happening this week. And we'll have more stuff next week as well, including more from Frank's shop, the Sold Effects shop, and a new project from Simone. So please check that out on test.com. But until then, this intro or this outro is by
Justin, aka Speed. Who else?
All right.
Hi there, I didn't see you.
Tested.
You can hold out your hand and guess how many balls are in your hand.
Is that true?
I'm in, man.
That sounds great.
There are parts of San Francisco you can do that in real life.